The name of the new chapter we are going to study is Peasants and Farmers. The coming of modern agriculture in England. In the months that followed, cases of fires were reported from many districts. At some times, only rick was burned. At other times, the entire farmhouse was burned. The time of open fields and the commons. So peasants cultivated on strips of lands around the villages. New demands for grains. By the end of 18th century, France was at war with the England, and this disrupted the trade and import of food grains from the Europe. The prices of food grains in England skyrocketed, that means they became very high, and encouraging the landowners to enclose the lands and enlarge the area under the grain cultivation. Profits flowed in. Landowners were pressurized, and they also pressurized the parliament to pass the enclosure acts. The age of enclosures. Enclosures were now seen as very much necessary to make the long-term investments on lands and plan the crop rotations to improve the soil. Enclosures also allowed the richer landowners to expand the land under their control and produce more for the market. What happened to the poor people? And when fences came up, the enclosed land became the exclusive property of one landowner. Poor could no longer collect their firewood from the forests. Or graze their cattle on the commons. Everything belonged to the landlords. Everything had a price for which the poor could not afford to pay. Laborers were being paid wages and employed only during the harvesting time. Landowners tried to increase their profits. They cut the amount they had to spend on the workmen. Work became insecure. Employment became uncertain. Income became unstable. For a very large part of the year, the poor had no work at all. In this image, we see worried farmers sitting on empty land. The introduction of threshing machines. During the Napoleonic Wars, the prices of food grains were very high. Farmers expanded production vigorously, and fearing a shortage of labor, they began buying new threshing machines which came into the market. They complained of the insolence of the laborers, their drinking habits, and the difficulty of making them work. The machines, they thought, would help them reduce their dependence on laborers. In this image, we see the threshing machine. Bread basket and dust bowl. USA became the bread basket of the world. Most of the landscape was not under the control of white Americans. Till the 1780s, white American settlements were confined to a narrow strip of coastal land only in the east. By the early 20th century, landscape transformed radically. White Americans moved westwards and established their control up to the west coast, displacing the local tribes and carving out the entire landscape into different agricultural belts. USA came to be known as to dominate the world market in agricultural produce. Westward move and wheat cultivation. In the decades after 1800, the US government committed itself to a policy of driving the American Indians westwards, first beyond the river Mississippi and then further west. Numerous wars were waged in which the Indians were massacred and many of the villages burned. Indians resisted. They won many victories in the wars, but they were ultimately forced to sign the treaty, give up their land and move westward. They plowed the land and sowed corn and wheat. In this image, we see the wheat crop. In the early years, the fertile soil produced good crops. When the soil became impoverished and exhausted in one place, the migrants would move further west to explore new lands and to raise a new crop. It was, however, only after the 1860s, settlers swept into the Great Plains across the River Mississippi. In the subsequent decades, this region became a major wheat-producing area of the America. The wheat farmers' urban population in the USA was growing and the export market was becoming bigger. As the demand increased, the wheat prices rose up. It encouraged the farmers to produce wheat. Spread of the railways made it easy to transport their grain from wheat growing regions to the eastern coast for the export. In this image, we see the wheat crop being harvested. During the First World War, the world market boomed. Russian supplies of the wheat were cut off and USA had to feed Europe. US President Wilson, he called upon the farmers to respond to the need of the time. Plant more wheat. Wheat will win the war, he said. The coming of new technology. In 1831, the Cyrus McCormick, he invented the first mechanical reaper, which could cut in one day as much as 5 men could cut with cradles and 16 men with sickles. By the early 20th century, most of the farmers were using combined harvesters to cut the grain. With one of these machines, 500 acres of wheat could be harvested in 2 weeks. In this image, we see Cyrus McCormick with his mechanical reaper. These new machines allowed the big farmers to rapidly clear large tracts of land, break up the soil, remove the grass, and prepare the ground for cultivation. The work could be done very quickly with a minimal number of hands. Dust Bowl. When wheat cultivation expanded dramatically in the early 20th century, the zealous farmers recklessly uprooted all the vegetation and tractors turned the soil over and the broken the sod into the dust. The whole region became a dust bowl. American dream of a land of plenty had turned into a nightmare. Settlers thought that they could conquer the entire landscape, turn all the land over to growing crops, which could yield the profits. After the 1930s, the Indian farmer and opium production. During the colonial period, rural India came to produce a majority of range of crops for the world market. In the early 19th century, indigo and opium were major commercial crops. By the end of the century, the peasants were producing sugarcane, cotton, jute, wheat, and several other crops for export to feed the population of urban Europe and also to supply to the mills of Lancashire and Manchester in England. As cultivation expanded, the area under the forests and pastures declined. All this created many problems for the peasants and pastoralists. They found their access to the forests and grazing lands increasingly restricted by the rules and regulations. A taste for tea, the trade with China. In the late 18th century, the English East India Company, it was buying tea and silk for China for sale in England. So it was buying tea and silk from China for the sale in England. As tea became popular English drink, the tea trade became more and more important. While the English cultivated a taste for the Chinese tea, the Chinese became addicted to the opium. People of all the classes, they took to the drug shopkeepers and peddlers, officials and army men, aristocrats and paupers. China became a country of opium addicts. British trade in the tea flourished. The returns from opium sale financed the tea purchases in China. Where did opium come from? Supplies had to be increased to feed this booming export trade. But this was not easy. For a variety of reasons, they were unwilling to turn their fields over to the poppy. First, the crop had to be grown on the best land, on fields that lay near the villages and were well manured. On this land, peasants usually produced pulses. If they planted opium on this land, then pulses could not be grown there, or they would have to be grown on inferior land where the harvests were poorer and uncertain. Second, many cultivators owned no land. To cultivate, they had to pay the rent and lease the land from the landlords. And the rent charged on good lands near the villages was very high. Third, the cultivation of opium was a very difficult process. Plant was delicate. Cultivators had to spend long hours nurturing it. This meant that they did not have enough time to care for other crops. Finally, the price the government paid to the cultivators for the opium they produced, it was very low. It was unprofitable to the cultivators to grow opium at that price. How were the unwilling cultivators made to produce opium? Unwilling cultivators were made to produce opium through a system of advances. In the rural areas of Bengal and Bihar, there were large numbers of poor peasants. They never had enough to survive. It was difficult for them to pay the rent to the landlord or to buy food and clothing. When offered a loan, the cultivators were tempted to accept, hoping to meet their immediate needs and pay back the loan at a later stage. The cultivator was forced to grow opium on a specified area of land and hand over the produce to the agents once the crop has been harvested. He had no option of planting the field with a crop of his choice or selling his produce to anyone but the government agent. And he had to accept the low price offered for the produce. This conflict between the British government, peasants, local traders continued as long as the opium production lasted.